All right, welcome back. Looks like there's a career fair today, so it'll be a low turnout. That's fine, it'll be recorded for posterity. We should all be working or getting started on the next assignment, which is assignment number 3, which is adding JavaScript and AngularJS to the current assignment that we're working on throughout the semester. And we had started on that a little bit earlier this week, right, where we saw how to add AngularJS and add a very simple routing mechanism that allowed us to implement a very simple single-page application. So I'd like to revisit that, right, perhaps do it again from scratch, and see how that can be built into the current assignment that you should all be working on. Okay, I'll start working on the first couple of pages, the login, the registration, the profile, and work our way towards perhaps some of the website pages, so that you can then reuse what we see here in class to extrapolate out of that and complete. And refactor all the other pages. All right. Any questions on the general questions on the assignment that we're working on? It's basically refactoring what we already have that we completed for assignment 2. All right. So let's see. Let's start working on this. And some of the things that we were supposed to do is take out the original pages. And refactor them in such a way that they're ready to be used as views and templates in AngularJS applications. So let's get started. Get started with declaring an Angular application. So let's do that. So here are the couple of pages that we already have so far. Notice that I'm going to do it under the assignment directory. All right, so this should mimic or parallel somewhat what you might already have in your own implementation. So under here, we now have the index page, which is nothing but a placeholder. Right? It's not doing anything yet. Right? If we navigate to that page, right now the index page, there's really nothing in there. Right? Assignment home page. And so this is going to be the container of our Angular application, right? It's going to load all the libraries we need, JavaScript libraries we need, all the CSS libraries we will need, and also do all the common things that we need across the entire application. And this is the only page that we'll ever load, right? And we'll never navigate away from this index page, right? Instead, we're going to be systematically loading various HTML snippets of code. Angular will load these HTML snippets of code and paint the page based on those snippets of code. All right, by loading them and updating the DOM accordingly. Okay. All right, so let's get started. So here's our index page. We're going to need the Angular library. And so let's go fetch it from an Angular CDN. So let's see, we'll say AngularJS CDN. Google is a good place to get it from. If you go there, we can copy their script tag and just drop it into our head tag, right? And now we have the Angular library, JavaScript library, installed on our single page application. We're going to need an additional Angular library to implement the navigational portion of this. Right? Angular has grown to be quite large, and they've broken it up into smaller pieces that you can then add different features on a neat basis. Okay? So that other library is the route library. And the routing library, which will allow us to implement navigation, right, using this new mechanism, right? Navigation not by hyperlinks that navigate between different HTML pages, but instead navigation by loading these views, right, and updating the DOM without actually reloading the entire page. Okay, so the library is implemented under route angular-route.min.js. Okay. There we go. So we have all the JavaScript libraries we need. We're going to now also load the CSS library that we'll need across the entire application, which in our case here is the Bootstrap CSS library. And I've installed it here at the top level under CSS Bootstrap. In a production environment, it's preferable to use a CDN, right? But I'm developing, and it's often convenient in a development environment to have the library actually copied physically on the IDE. The IDE will use the CSS library to do autocomplete, right, and do auto suggestions as you type, which is very convenient for when you're developing. So I'm going to load that library using link and href. And I believe it's up one, and then down to CSS, and down to Bootstrap. There it is. Okay. Also, we'll say that this is a style sheet. Very good. All right, so the title of this might be assignment home. I'll leave that. In here, we're also going to have to load the actual JavaScript application, our application, implemented in its own JavaScript file. Right? The assignment suggests that we implement it in a file called app.js. Okay, it suggests. So let me see here. Right, it suggests to declare your Angular application in the app.js file. It's a very common name for the module, the top level module that starts off, declares your application. Right. Let's do that. Let's load that app.js. Well, we don't have it. Let's create it. We'll say under the assignment, we'll create app.js. We'll say new JavaScript file app.js. In here, we're going to declare our Angular application. So when you load the Angular library over here, it declares a top level a global variable called Angular, right? And this object that is now in the global namespace can be accessed anywhere after you load your Angular library. So from anywhere, from now on, for instance, in here, in my own app.js, I can name this object and use all the functionality that is encapsulated in this object. Okay. So I could just go on and start using Angular, right? Start declaring modules and whatnot. Now, it's best practice that any of your code, not be declared or litter the global namespace, right? Anything you declare here at the top level, if you say var, a equal 1, 2, 3, we are declaring a variable at the global namespace, right? If I declare a function here, add, that adds two numbers, right, and returns the summation of these two numbers, I'm declaring this function at the top level namespace, right? If, God forbid, someone else in some other library declares a function of the same exact name, add, it would override my function, right? Or if, God forbid, some other library declared add and I declare my own function, I would be overriding their function, right? There's no such thing as overloading in JavaScript, right? Last one wins. The last function with the same name just overrides any prior declaration of any other function. Right? So we have to make sure that at least on the browser side, where we're competing with many other libraries, right, we have to make sure that we manage these namespaces. Right? One typical way of dealing with these name clashes, with these namespaces, is to use a technique called the immediately invoked function expressions. Okay? Which basically is declaring an anonymous function, declaring an anonymous function in JavaScript, meaning a function that has no name. Right? You declare a function like this that has no name, and then putting all your code inside of that function. Right? Because functions in JavaScript, like many other functions in any other language, declares a local namespace. Yes? That is not accessible from anywhere outside of the function. Which is exactly what we want. We want a namespace that, from outside, you cannot access. Right? You cannot compete with that local namespace. If you declare anything in this function, it only ever lives inside of this function. Make sense? That's what local namespaces are. That's what a function does. So we're going to take advantage of that feature, right? But we want the function to actually execute. We want this function to be invoked. So we might call it something like init, perhaps, right? And then do all our work inside of this init. But somebody has to invoke this, right? Somebody has to invoke this. So typically it would be something like init, right? And then you call this function. But again, we are littering the namespace by declaring a function init. What if some other namespace or some other library also declares a function init? That's the whole point. We don't want to compete with that namespace, right? So we don't want to use any name for this function. We don't want to use any particular name for this function because, again, we don't want to compete. But nevertheless, we need to invoke it. Somebody has to invoke it because my code is inside of the function. Yes? So we can use JavaScript's feature that functions, like any other variable, right, can be passed as arguments, right? Can be passed as arguments. So this is an argument right here, some object that I'm referring to it by parentheses, right, as an argument. And what operation do I want to do on that particular object? I want to invoke it, right? And that's what the second set of parentheses does, right? Whatever's on the left-hand side better be a function. Right, because I am going to invoke it. That's what these two parentheses do at the end. Right? It invokes the operation of invoking. Right? And it can only be applied on objects that are of type functions. Right? Just like if these were numbers, I should be able to invoke addition. Right? If these were strings, I should be able to invoke concatenation. Yes? On functions, what can I do with functions? I can invoke, you know, apply, invoke yourself, execute. And that's what these two parentheses do. Make sense? Everybody okay? Now, whatever I declare in here will execute and will not compete with namespaces from outside. Everybody okay? All right. So this is a best practice that, you know, it's fairly common in industry, right? You should unless it's code that you're going to just play around a little bit and try it out just because you want to understand a couple of things and it's your own code and you're not going to be competing with anybody and you're not part of a team, unless it's that kind of code. If it's industrial code that's going to be used in a larger environment, it should always be within an iffy expression. Okay? All right, it's a best practice. All right, so in here, I'm going to use Angular. Any code I would have used anyway, I'm just going to always wrap it with this immediately invoking function expression. All right. So Angular, what am I going to do? I'm going to declare a top-level module. I'm going to give it a name. It'll be the name of my application. Right? Angular, you can declare any number of modules. One of them has to be the top-level module, right, where everything gets started, right, and it's responsible for loading maybe other modules. Okay, our module we're going to call it Web App Maker, and for now it's not going to depend on anyone. Right? It's not going to have any dependencies. Okay. Now this name, coupled with the ng app attribute, right, can be used to declare the top level module as the application, right, the application that Angular application, which is going to be the container of all other modules. Okay, so this name here, web app maker, needs to match this string right here. Okay, if we reload the index page, where'd it go? We reload it, we won't see any market difference other than some errors. Okay, so this is saying I parsed your HTML. You declared an ng app to be web app maker, but I never found the declaration of that top level module. Where is it? And it's here in app.js, but I never loaded app.js. You see that? So let's load our app.js. App.js. If we reload, notice that it's not complaining anymore. Everybody okay? All right. Okay, so all right, so we have a very dummy web app maker. It's not really doing anything. What we're going to try and do is to reuse the pages that we already have, login, profile, register, right, and refactor them to use Angular navigation. Right now, these pages are using the old style navigation, right? They're using, you know, plain old hyperlinks, right here. They're using just plain old hyperlinks to navigate between the login, the registration page, and the profile pages, which is pretty much what you should have already. And I believe it works. If I navigate to login, there is login, right? If I click on login, it navigates to the profile page. If I log out, it goes back to the login. If I click on register, it goes to the register page, right? If I register, it goes to profile, which is somewhat what you might already have already implemented for the previous assignment. So we're going to refactor this to use Angular navigation, right? Instead of using the old style, what we're referring to the legacy mechanism of navigation. Okay. So to do that, what we're going to do is that we're going to be using the routing library, to implement the navigation. So to do that, we're going to tell the top level module, our web app maker module, we're going to tell it, hey, I want to use that routing library, right, that you loaded over there. So I'm going to say that the top level module depends on this other module, meaning load this other module, right? And each module has its own unique name, right? This one in particular has the name ng-route. Okay, that's the name of that other module, which is declared right here by this route min. Right? Route min declares that other module. We'll see a little later how to declare modules and load custom modules. Right now, we're just using this other module that somebody else wrote, and you can just load it and then refer to it by name over here. Okay, notice that web app maker is declaring a module called web app maker. Somebody else could declare a module and refer to it by this name, web app maker. So you could create like a pyramid of modules depending on other modules, depending on other modules, right? We're not going to do that just now. We're just going to assume that there's this other module that I'm loading and it's called ng-route and it's declared right here. Everybody okay? All right. So what we want to do here is that we want to strategically load various pieces of HTML, right, as we go, as we navigate between one HTML snippet of code to the other, right? And we're going to tell it that this is where we want all those snippets of code to go. I'm going to say div, and then we're going to say ng-view, right? What this says is that this is where we want to inject the content as we navigate between the various pages, right? Sometimes I want to show login page, sometimes register page, sometimes a profile page. They're all going to be injected into this placeholder. Okay? Right now, there's nothing in it. Right now, there's nothing. So what do we want to show first, right? If I go to my top level, right now it's just showing index.html, correct? So what I need to do is map various routes, right? Various URLs, right? To different pieces of HTML that I want to display. So I need to configure these routing mechanisms, right? So to do that, we're going to do that in a separate JavaScript file, right? And we're going to declare it in a file called config.js, right? Config.js. Config.js is going to allow us to configure all the various routing mechanisms to navigate between the various pages, right? And in the assignment, we've given you a starting example of what that might look like, okay? And here it is. I'm just going to copy it and declare it inside of my new config file. Let me say new config.js, right? What this says is that this says, notice that we're still using that iffy, right? And so any JavaScript code that you write, at least in this class, should always be inside of an iffy statement, right? I should never see any JavaScript outside of an iffy statement, all right? That's a requirement on all your assignments going forward, okay? So all the code is nicely protected within an iffy namespace, right? The first line says, "Hey, you know that module you declared earlier in a previous call or in a previous use of the Angular library? Well, I want to refer to it. I want to refer to it. So I'm kind of like referring to that module that was declared earlier. Where in app.js? App.js declared it earlier, right? I'm referring to it right now over here. Yes." Okay, now that I have it, it's an object. I can keep calling methods on it to converse with this module. One of the functions that this object returns, this module returns, is a config function. This config function allows me to configure the module, right? So it gets loaded, right? And then I can configure all sorts of things, right? One of the things that I can configure is the routing mechanism, right? I can configure the routing mechanism. And the way it's configured is by providing, as an argument, a function, right? As an object, as an argument, right? This object is, this function is declared down here. It's a function that is declared way down here with a name. It doesn't matter that I use a name for the function because this function only exists inside of this namespace, right? I can reuse this name for this function elsewhere, right? It will not conflict with this function, right? Because it only lives in this namespace. So the function, this config function, is an argument to this config function that is part of the Angular framework, all right? And this config function behaves in a particular manner, right? Any function that you pass it will be invoked by the framework, meaning it will call your function with arguments that you are going to ask for, right? You're going to ask for certain parameters, right? This is an idea that was borrowed from the server side that's been around for at least a decade. A decade and a half, which is called inversion of control, okay? Instead of declaring a very well defined set of parameters, right? And you have to call that function with exactly the same parameters, right? In the particular order, right? Instead, we invert the responsibility. It is the function who decides what it wants to be invoked with, right? Which is somewhat extraneous, right? You're inverting here the responsibility. Typically, when you declare a function
that takes two integers, right? Those the parameters are set in stone. You better call them with those two integers, correct? Right? And that has been like that for forever, right? For you know, if you declare a function add, and you're expecting two integers, well, you better call them with those two integers, right? 1, 2, and the order matters. Right, this maps that one first integer, and this one maps that second integer, correct? Well, inversion of control inverts the role and gives the function the capability of asking for things, right? It says, no, I want them in this other order, right? And whoever the caller is needs to adapt to whatever the function wants. Okay. This is an idea that was fairly powerful, right? That you do not need to adhere to APIs. Right? You can just ask by name, what is it that I want you to be invoked with? Here, the config function is asking the framework, hey, invoke me with an instance of this variable. Okay, right. It's sometimes referred to as injection. Right? It's an idea that we're going to be using all throughout the semester. Right, we're going to be asking for things that already exist in the framework, and you say, hey, pass me an instance of that object by name, and the framework is going to look up, right, all the variables that instances that it has, and it says, oh, is that what you want? Okay, I will invoke you with an instance of that object. Okay, very, very powerful idea. Okay, again, it's gonna be used throughout the semester over and over. So what are we asking for here? The config function is asking to be invoked with an instance of this object, right? And this object has that specific name, right? It has that specific name. It has to be exactly that name. Notice that it has a dollar sign in front of it, right? This hints at the fact that this is a framework variable. Right? It's a variable that the framework is going to pass through. It's not one of your variables. It's a variable that the framework knows about. Right? All variables that are declared by the Angular framework, they all start with dollar sign. Okay? We're going to be using dollar sign scope, dollar sign HTTP, you know, all sorts of dollar sign variables all throughout the semester. Okay? This is one of them. Right? This is a variable that is declared and instantiated by the router module. The router module that we're loading in the Angular second script that we're loading in index.html declares all sorts of variables, right? And submodules. This is one of them. Okay? And here we're asking it by name. And the config function is going to look up this route provider. Says, hey, who declared it? Oh, you routing module, you declare all these variables. This, you know, give me an instance of it so I can pass it along to the config function over here. Right? And there's a lot of magic that happens behind. We're going to tap into that magic, right? We're going to create our own providers, we're going to create our own services, and we're going to be able to create our own. Okay? But we're not there yet. Right? For now, and let's be content with understanding that the routing module declared all these variables, and we can ask them by name. Make sense? All right. Okay, it gets passed to us. There it is. Route provider, we now have it. We now have an instance of that object. And that object is used, this particular object is used to configure the navigation, right? That if you see certain URL pattern, this is the HTML that you should see. If you see this other URL pattern, then you should see this other HTML. Okay. For instance, we can say that if you don't see anything, slash, okay, we want to show the login page.
okay, which we have. We have the login page. There it is. We can actually navigate to it, can't we? Right, it's somewhere in there, isn't it? Login HTML. It's there. That's what we want to see, right, if we are at the slash. Okay? All right, so it's configured. Let's load it from our index page. Okay, we did load it. If we refresh, notice what happens. Notice what's happening. See that? If I put a slash, if I put a slash and I don't ask for anything in particular, what's going to happen? It's going to load login.html. See there? All right? Actually, I can map it to whatever I want. Say I want to map it to XYZ. Right now, it doesn't match anything, right? What happens is that whatever occurs after the hash, whatever happens after the hash, is going to be compared to all these URL patterns, right? It's going to be compared to these URL patterns. If it doesn't find it, it says, "Sorry, I don't know where to go with that. That I don't understand that URL pattern, right?" But I can map it. I can say, "Oh, you know what? That XYZ." I want to map it to the template URL login HTML. If I save that, and now I refresh, notice that now slash XYZ is mapped to the login page. You see that? Right? So I can create all sorts of rules here of navigation. Right? This is implementing a centralized controller. This is implementing the centralized controller that implements all the navigation. Right? We are delegating the task and the role of navigation. We're delegating it. We're moving it from the pages, right? We're moving it from hard coding it in the pages. We're moving it to a centralized place configured in one single maintenance file. Okay. I'm not going to use XYZ. I'm going to use login. Logging is a much better name. So that means now that logging is now mapped to the login page. No, that didn't work. Did I save this? Login. Okay, there it is. Login. But now my slash is not mapped, right? So slash is not mapped. Okay. So I could create an otherwise. Otherwise is a kind of like a default, right? If it doesn't match any of the previous mappings, right? If it doesn't match, if I don't know where to send you, right? I can default to a particular location. And I think it's called redirect. Redirect. Direct to, is it? Login.html. Let me see if that's true. That's not it, right? Did I miss a parenthesis somewhere? Oh, it's an object. Redirect. Let me look it up just a second. Otherwise, it's just plain old redirect, not redirect to. Redirect. Did I save login? Redirect. Oh, I'm sorry. Redirect to. And what you put here as arguments is where you want to go, login, right? Meaning a name of the route, login. And if I don't provide anything, it doesn't go. Redirect. Did I save this? I did save it, didn't I? Otherwise, redirect. Am I missing something? Redirect. Update, yada, yada, yada. redirect to slash. Otherwise, it is redirect to. There we go. Right, if I don't put anything, it redirects. Or I put something that is gibberish, right? It redirects me to the login. Make sense? Everybody okay? Everybody still with me? All right. What about all the other pages? I could navigate and say, well, if I ask for register, then I'm going to go to the register page. Register. Right. So if I type here register, I navigate to the register page. You see that? Okay. Notice that we're not physically navigating to the page. I am not typing register.html. Yes? Right. Instead, I am delegating the actual fetching of the HTML to a centralized controller. Right. What this is going to allow me to do is that now the pages no longer need to specifically refer your hard code the actual HTML. Right. So let's play around with that. If I go to my login page, now all my hyperlinks, instead of pointing to profile.html or pointing to register.html, what I can do is replace this with slash register. You see that? Now my login page doesn't know anything about a register.html page. Doesn't know where it physically lives. Yes? Now I'm free to move around the pages. I can move them around anywhere I want physically. Yes? Right? Instead, they are notifying the centralized controller, hey, the user has the intent to go to the register page, wherever that is. It is not my responsibility to interpret it. Right? I am delegating that to somebody with a higher pay grade. Okay? Somebody else knows better than me where that lives. Right? It is not my responsibility. Okay? And same thing with the register page. We could do something similar. Instead of the register page knowing physically where the login page lives, right, we can remove that responsibility by saying, I'm going to go to the login. And so this is a much higher level thinking about this, right? You can think about it at a higher level as opposed to physically knowing where the login page is. I am delegating that to a centralized power, right? So if I refresh now and the register page, if I hover over register, cancel, notice that now it's /login, right? It doesn't know that it's actually going to the login page. Now if I click on cancel, right, it goes to the login page. See that? So I have exactly the same functionality of navigation, yes, that I had earlier, but implemented in a different way. One, I'm using single page application, right? I'm not actually reloading the page, right? It's still fetching the HTML, yes, but then it's caching it here in the DOM. It's updating the DOM dynamically. So we don't have the jarring reloading of the page and re-rendering of the page, right? Whenever we just have to update just a tiny bit of the page. And also, we are using a best practice of not delegating the navigation to a centralized controller. So if I click on register, I can now navigate between these two pages, just like I did earlier. Right? So I have the same capability, the same functionality. Everybody okay? Right. Now notice what happens in the network. In the network, we can see the chatter going back and forth. Right. If I click on register, notice that it's still going to fetch that HTML. See that? It's still going to fetch it. We'll do a cancel. It's still fetching the login page. Right. But notice that when I clear this, and I go to register. Notice that it doesn't fetch the HTML again. See that? It didn't fetch the HTML because it has it cached already in the memory of the browser. It didn't have to fetch the HTML again. Why is it fetching the CSS again? It's because we haven't gone to the next step, right? We don't need to fetch this all these bootstrap because I already have it, right? Index already loaded this, right? There's no need to reload it, right? So let's go on to the next step. Right. Is everybody okay? Are we still following? Right. Before we go on, let's plug in the very last portion. Let's go on to the login page and navigate to the profile page as well. We're going to say /profile if you click on the login page. And in the register page, we're going to say, if you click on register, I'm going to navigate to the profile page. Okay? If we refresh this, if I cancel, I can go to a login page. If I click on login, it's complaining that profile, notice profile, it's not mapped to anything, right? Since it's not mapped to anything, what's the default thing to do? Is to go to the login page, right? So notice if I click on login, it doesn't go anywhere. It just stays here. So we need to map that, right? We need to map it in the centralized configuration, routing configuration. We're going to say that if I see profile, I'm going to navigate to profile.html. Okay? Right? So if we log in and we click on login, now we navigate to the profile. Everybody still with me? Right, so we can now navigate. How about logout? Logout should take me back to login page. So let's fix that too. So profile, if I do a logout, where's logout? There it is. It goes back to login. Right. So if I hover over logout, notice that it's pointing to now to hash login. Right. And I can click on it takes me back to login. So now I have full navigation between all the three pages. Everybody okay? Everybody still with me? All right. Let's see. Now that we have that, let's visit these three pages: login, profile, and register. We'll notice that they all seem to have a lot in common, right? They're all HTML documents. They all have a head. They all have a body. Notice that they all have these links, you know, loading these bootstrap and the style sheets, correct? Right? Well, there's no need to declare all this HTML, all this head, all this body, because the index page already declared it. Yes? So we don't need that anymore. We're going to remove that from here. Also, notice that it's loading its own bootstrap. It's loading its own style sheet. Okay? But those are the same bootstrap and the same style sheet that I need all throughout the entire application, right? So what we're going to do is that we're going to copy anything that is common, right? And we're just going to put it in the index page. We're going to put it in the index page. So we already have Bootstrap. I'm not going to load that anymore again, right? I am going to load the style.css, right, that lives under here. I'm going to load that. But everything else, like login page, let's go to a login page. I don't need any of this. So I'm just going to remove it. Right, I needed it when we were not a single page application. Yes? When each page was meant to stand alone on its own. Yes? But now we're not. Right? We are actually just snippets of code that we're being injected into the outer shell. Correct? So all these are just instead of being full-blown pages, we're not going to be referring to these pages as pages anymore. Right? I mean, we would, but we are. But we're going to refer to pages in a very loose sense. Okay. Instead, we're going to refer to them with a more generic term. We're going to refer to them as templates. But templates that are meant to render dynamically, maybe perhaps render some dynamic content, right? Okay. And have some relationship with some back-end logic, okay? So they're not just pages in the sense of standalone HTML web pages, right? They're templates, snippets of code that are meant to be brought together to draw a larger portion of the application. So if we go back to a login page and I refresh, notice that it renders exactly the same way. See that? It renders exactly the same way, even though we remove the HTML, the body, and all those styles, because the index page is already loading all that. Okay? So we're going to do the same thing for all the pages. So I'm going to go to register page. Again, I'm going to strip out all this. We don't need it anymore. Okay? And same thing for the profile page. We're going to strip out all this stuff that we don't need anymore. Okay, so let's refresh. I'm logging into login. Notice that it renders exactly the same way. All right, log out, and I register. It goes to register page. So it's good, right? So it looks like we were able to strip out the pieces that we didn't need anymore. Everybody okay? Are you still with me? All right, so... So remember that one of the things that we gained by removing the hyperlinks from the pages, for instance, from login, we ripped out the direct reference to the profile page. We ripped out the direct reference to the register page. One of the things improvements was that what if we physically move these pages around or rename them? Yes? Say I wanted to rename login page, right? Well, if I rename login page, I would have to go and update all the pages, all the other hyperlinks that refer to the login page, right? In this case, who used to refer to the login page? The profile page, right? If I log out. And the register page, if I cancel, correct? They both refer to the login.html page, right? But because we're no longer, because profile, instead of referring to login.html, instead is using this high level kind of intention, right? Because it's delegating that, right? Same thing here, register. We took out login.html here, right? And instead, we replaced it with this. And instead, what we did is we centralized that here. What that bought us was that if I rename it, and I say login dot whatever, right? What happens is that I only have to update it here. Login dot whatever, right? And everything still works. Cancel goes back to login page. I didn't have to update register. I didn't have to update profile. I have a single point of maintenance. See that? Right? As opposed to having to go and update all the HTML pages that refer to this one page. You see that? They're very, very powerful, especially if you have dozens, hundreds of pages, right? That now you're free. Right, to move pages around, reorganize it, right, and you just have to update one single place. That's very, very powerful. Right? That's a lot of money in your pocket instead of having to spend time, to update tons and tons of different places. Single points of maintenance. Okay, very, very powerful. Okay, so we're not going to call them whatever. Instead, we're going to give them names that capture their role in their application. Okay, the roles is that these are templates, right? Or another high-level name is that these are views, right? These are the responsibility, the role of this particular artifact, this particular file, is to be rendered in front of a human being, right? A human being is going to consume this content, right? So dot view is going to capture that, right? The other thing that we're going to add here is where in the application is this content being generated or where is it being implemented? Okay, who's responsible for this particular file? In a very broad sense, applications typically have. Two or three different buckets of responsibility. One of them is the front end. Usually we have developers that are only dedicated to the front end. Okay, or you have developers that are responsible for the back end, right? For the server creating all the web services, and perhaps you might also have someone who's dedicated at implementing the database. Okay,
More recently, you find developers who are happy to be anywhere, right? To be in the front end, in the middle tier, or being also in the database, right? And we often refer to these folks as, you know, full stack engineers, right? They feel comfortable at any level, at anywhere in the tiers of the application.
Nevertheless, it's important to capture here, you know, who is this particular artifact? Where is it part of? Is it part of the client, you know, in the browser? Is it part of the server? Is it part of the database? Where is it? All right. So we're going to add here client. Okay. So what this allows me to do is now developers, when they look at this, and just by looking at the name, right, they immediately position themselves. Where am I in the application?
Okay. You know, it makes it very, very. It helps a lot to the developer just by looking at the name, right? To mentally position themselves of where, what am I looking at? Okay, and map it directly of what is being displayed in front of the user, right? There are many different types of naming convention. This is just one of them. Okay, it's used very widely in industry. But you know, each team might have different naming conventions, right? Some will use we'll use acronyms, right? We'll, to shorten the names, right? Whatever the team decides, the developer should stick to the naming convention, right? To just increase the productivity of the team as a whole.
Okay. So this is a very common naming convention. Let's apply it to all these files. Okay, these are all views. So this will be profile.view.client. Why client, you might say? Isn't HTML already to capture the fact that this is in the client?
Yes, you could argue that, right? But HTML can be rendered dynamically, can be rendered in the client using JavaScript, right? But it could also be rendered dynamically on the server, right, using EJS. We'll do that towards the end of the class, of the course, right? Or using PHP, or using any number of server-side technologies, can also render dynamic HTML, correct? But on the server. Right? If this were HTML that would be rendered dynamically on the server, we would call this .view.server. Okay? And maybe .pjs, or .php, or .whatever. Right? Whatever technology we're using to render this. Make sense?
Right? But client immediately tells me, this is a dynamic content that is I'm dynamically rendering using JavaScript running on a browser, as opposed to this is dynamically generated with JavaScript or PHP or Ruby, right, running on a server. Yes? Right. So it helps immediately to position my mental. Let's see what else. We're going to refactor this. We're going to rename this to be .view.client. Okay? So notice that I changed this with no regards to what should happen to the HTML code. I don't have to touch the HTML code, right? Even though I rename these files, the HTML code does not change. And this is, you know, very, very powerful, again, for maintenance purposes, right? And again, more than half of the budget that goes into any application is maintaining it. You know, somebody having to do, bug fixes or refactoring, moving things around because new business requirements. So I only have one single place where I need to update. Here I can just say view.client, right? I can just go in and re-update my JavaScript and reconfigure this. And notice that my page still works, right? Everything works just the same. I can go and log in, log out, register. Everybody okay? All right. Okay, that's great. Now, another fix that we're gonna fix that we're gonna do here, or refactoring that we're gonna do, is that we're gonna have lots and lots of these views. Okay, at least three per entity type, right? These three are going to be for the user. Then we're going to have three more for the websites, and then three more for the pages, and then three or four, or even 10 for the widgets,
right? So we're gonna the names of page, the number of pages just gonna explode, right? On how many you have these, right? So something typical that we might do is organize these and group these by the type of thing that these pages manipulate. Right? These three pages are typically they manipulate or interact with user-related data. Right? Login is we have to identify the user. We have to look up the user, right? We have to verify that this user's login is so-and-so. The register, same thing, right? We need to look up if the user already exists. We have to create this new user, right? And profile, we have to display the currently logged in user, which allows them to update it. So it's all about the user, right?
So a common practice is to group pages that are related to one another under a under a directory such as user, right? And so we can move these three, right, and put them under user. Again, to organize, right, to wrap our way to manage complexity, right? You know, much of what we do in developing application is managing the complexity of the application as it grows over time, right? And again, the way any which way that your particular team decides to organize the code, you know, you should try and keep, you know, stick to whatever methods that the team agrees. All right, so we put it under user. That means that we have to go back and notice that if I do this, notice that it's not finding the page anymore, right? Because I moved it. I put it in a different directory. That means I have to go back and update my single point of maintenance. I can say all these are under user. Right? So if I refresh, they're back. We're okay. Right? Cancel goes to login. Login goes to profile. Everybody good? All right, so let's keep going. The next one would be to navigate to websites. Right now, if I click on websites, it goes somewhere that does not exist. Website-list.html. That doesn't exist. Okay. But over the weekend, last weekend, I built something that could be used as a template for that. Right. I'm going to grab that as a starting point and put it here so that I can continue. Right. So first of all, notice that it's trying to navigate it away from index. Right, so that should not be the case. I don't want to navigate from index. So let's refactor that. Profile wants to go where? If I click on this website, I don't want to go to website list.html. I want to notify the central controller that my intention is to go to websites. Okay. Or actually, don't I give you a URL? I think I give you URL patterns, don't I? Oh, it's this one right here. Oh, okay. So this is the naming convention, right? This is the naming convention. User ID, user. Okay. All right. We'll get to this in a minute. So website, just website. Okay. Just plain old website. That means that I'm gonna have a file, right? That lists all the websites, so I better have that, right? And I need to navigate to it, don't I? Let me copy what one of those that we were working on last week. I believe it was, maybe was it Sandbox? I forget. Was it Sandbox? Bootstrap. I think maybe left scroll. Let me see if that's the one. So I'm going to navigate to. Oops, sandbox, left scroll. That looks okay, but the coloring looks weird. Nevertheless, I'm just going to copy this HTML over, right? And I'm going to rename it as websites.html, right? So I'm going to copy this index. I'm going to copy it. I'm going to bring it over. I'm going to paste it in here. I'm going to give it the name website-list.html. Okay? There it is, website-list.html. And the profile the profile, if I click on websites, wants to navigate where? Hash website, yes? If I try to do that, let me go to the profile. Right, if I click on a website, notice that goes back to login, right? Because websites doesn't exist. It's not mapped to anything, right? It's not mapped to anything. So we need to declare in our config, we need to declare and say that if we do see the URL pattern website, we want to go where? To website list.html. Yes? Right? So let's see. Let's go back. Let's refresh. If I click on websites, indeed it navigates to this page, which is somewhat broken. We'll need to fix it, right? Probably because I copied it from a directory, I put it in a different directory, and it assumes the references to the CSS style sheets are probably broken. So let's see. Let's try and fix website list.html. It's, I believe it's this one. Let's see what it does. It's trying to load. Okay. Well, we don't need any of this, right? We don't need the HTML. We don't need the head. We definitely don't need this link to the Bootstrap, right? But I'm going to remove that. It is linking to styles.css, which is that one. Let's see. I believe it's this styles.css, which I believe it's different from this styles. Let's see if there's anything here that we want. All right, I overrode the color of the background, so it's this bluish color, right? So let's grab that from here, right, and move it onto the style sheet that we're using for the assignment. Let me copy it there. There it is. So that means that my website list doesn't need this link anymore, right? What else do we have here? Looks like I am overriding the margin of the input group. So let's grab that as well and copy it into our own style sheet. Where is it? I believe it's this one. Okay, there we go. What else? I think that's it. So that means that our website list doesn't need this style anymore. So I'm going to remove that. What else we have here? We have this style, which it's pushing down the whole body. But I think we have that already, right? We have that already. Well, maybe not. Let's see. We'll see. I'm going to remove that. Remove that. Okay. And what about the bottom? We don't need this anymore. All right. Okay, let's try that again. Let's refresh. It's still kind of broken. Let's see if we can fix it. Okay, let's see. The ng view, scope, the class. Let's put this at the bottom to see why this is so wide. It's a fluid nav bar. This is the nav bar. Probably because it's wrapping, right? It's wrapping. Do I have something here? Hidden fluid. Am I applying some styling here? Let me see. It's the very tippy top. We have these styles here. We have these other styles here. I was probably nudging things around left and right. Okay. Blah, blah, blah. Let's see if we can fix this. Nav bar. We have container fluid, and I'm not doing anything there. Nothing there. Is margin left? What is that? Okay, that controls that little arrow on the left. That's hyperlink over there. How about this over here? Oh, it looks like this is too large, right? So let's see if we can remove the width. Okay, that was it, right? I'm forcing the header to be 100% of the navbar header. Okay, and that lives in the styles.css. So let's go to the styles.css and remove that. It's not this style CSS. I believe it would be here. Okay, I think it's this what's screwing up our content. So I'm going to just comment it out. Notice that comments in CSS uses slash star, not slash slash. Okay? So let's refresh that. Okay, that looks okay. That looks okay. The hyperlinks don't look right. Let's override these styles for the hyperlinks. And so let's say that navbar brand, navbar header. So I want these all to be white. No, let me see, color white. I want those to be white. So all those are the nav brand. So let's change that. So let's change the color. And we'll say that all hyperlinks with navbar brand, I want all those to be color white. So let's refresh that. That didn't work. Inspect. Why didn't it work? Nav brand. Color. Okay, notice that it's overriding my style. See that? Because theirs is a little more specific. Right? They're going from navbar default nav brand. So what I'm going to do is that instead of trying to fight it, I'm going to take their exact rule. Right, their exact rule, and I'm going to override it. I'm going to say, oop, did I copy it? I thought I copied it. Copy. There it is. I'm going to take their exact rule, right, and because the mystyles.css is declared after the bootstrap, mine will win over theirs, right? So if I refresh, notice that I have this as white. Okay, I am overriding their own rule. Okay, mine is as specific as theirs are. Yes, yeah, you should try to avoid important. Only use it as a last resort. Okay, so first try to override the rules of Bootstrap, right? And yeah, use that as a last resort. Let's see, where are we? We have this over here, this, and we want to change the color of this to white as well. And so that would be all hyperlinks. Okay, so let's see where it's grabbing its own color, right? It says that it wants it to, let's see, is it that one? No, not, is it that blue, really? So it looks like it wants all anchors to be white, okay? Let's be more specific. Let's see if we create a rule that says span chevron left. No, let's be a little more generic. Maybe nav bar text followed by a. Then all hyperlinks of this, I want to the color to be white. Let's see if that works. That didn't work. Navbar text. Navbar text, why didn't you like that? Maybe a little more specific. How about in the navbar? And then it doesn't like that either. A span, maybe followed by a span. Really? Let's try that. Also, you can group rules. Maybe that's why that wasn't, because it was I didn't put the dots in front of it. You can group rules that what you want to share the same transformation, right, by using comma, right, meaning that all these rules, right, map to this transformation, right. So if we refresh, notice that now all my hyperlinks are white as well, right. I don't know that we had to be so specific. Perhaps navbar text would be enough. Okay, it is enough. You should try to be as specific as you need to be, but no more specific than you need to be, right? Because you might be going way broader than you need to be, right? And then you might be you might have creating some global effects, right? Global effects that you didn't intend to, right? So you should try to be as specific as you need to be, but no more than that. Okay, I'm sorry, as general as you can, but no more than that. All right, so we have that. Let's rename this a little bit. Let's according to the design, the website list. Oh, the website list is as simple as that. there is no left-hand side, right-hand side. Nevertheless, I'm going to leave it as this. I'm going to rename a couple of things. I'm going to rename this to say instead of left header, it'll say websites. And this one too, I'm going to say websites. And so it's going to look like that, websites and websites. Presumably on the left-hand side, these are a whole bunch of websites, okay? And if I click on this, presumably I would navigate to that particular set of pages. But we're not there yet. What I'd like to be able to do is go back. See that? If I click on back, I would like to go where? Back to the profile, right? Right now, it's not going anywhere. If I click on that, it's just going to the login page, right? Instead, let's change that. On the left-hand side, I want to go where? I want to go to profile. Yes? All right, so if I refresh, this back button, right, navigates me back to the profile page. See that? So I can now go between the websites, right, and then I can go back to the profile page. I can navigate between these two. Everybody okay? All right. If I go to websites and I click on plus, where do I want to go? To new websites, right? Websites new. So let's create from that template of website list. Let's copy this and let's rename this to website new. Yes, right. And maybe change a couple of titles here. We'll call this new website. Oh, I'm sorry, no. On the left-hand side, it should show the existing websites, and on the right-hand side, it should show what does the assignment say? It should say a new website, right? New website. So you should say something like new website on the right-hand side, right? So that means that if I click on plus, where do I want to go? To website new, I believe, right? Website slash new, right? I think that's what the assignment says. So let's do that. Let's go to website list. And the plus, where's the plus? Here's a plus. It's going to navigate to website slash new. Okay? Website slash new. So if I refresh this, right, if I click on plus, if I hover over it, notice that it says slash website new. Right? If I click on it, what's going to happen? It's not going to go anywhere, right? Because there's no mapping for that. There's no mapping. The page exists, but it hasn't been mapped. So if I click on it, it's going back to the login page because I don't know. There was no mapping for it. But no worries. Let's go to the config page and declare that new mapping. So it's going to be website slash new. It's going to go to website new. See that? So let's go back and refresh. Now if I click on plus, notice that it goes to new websites. Right, new website. Everybody okay? Right? If I'm standing at website list and I click on any of the cogs, here are the cogs, right? These are all the cogs. Where are they linking to? Right now, nowhere, right? But these should all link where? To website slash some ID, right? So presumably 123 perhaps, right? This one should map to 234. Right? This should map to maybe 345, the ID of the website. Right? So if I navigate here and I click on the cog, notice that it highlights, right? I hover and it says website slash 123. And if I hover over the second one, it says wait, what happened? Did we do that? I thought we did. Did I skip one? This one, two, and three. Oh, I did the wrong. It's the cog, right? It's the cog. The cog is, this is the cog. There we go. And this is not the cog, right? It's the cog is down here. There's a cog. Let's try that again. So if I hover over the first one, it has website slash 123, then website slash 234, and website slash 345, right? If I navigate to any one of these, obviously it doesn't go anywhere, right? Because they haven't been mapped. If I click here, none of them are mapped, right? So that means they need to be mapped so that they navigate where? To website edit, yes? But website edit doesn't exist. Let's create a placeholder for website edit. So I'm just going to copy website new, and I'm going to call it website edit, right? And I'm just going to change a couple of things here. I'm going to call this edit website, right? So that we know we're going to that page, yes? All right, so the cogs needs to navigate. So all those three cogs should navigate to this one page, yes? All right, so how do we configure that? What we want to say here is that we want to say, if I go to website 123, I want to go to website edit, right? And if I have 234, then I still want to go to the edit, right? Or 345 goes to the same edit, right? Let's see if that works. If I click on here and I click on the cog, notice that it goes to edit website, right? If I go back and I click on this cog, it still goes to edit website. Right, but this doesn't work very well, right? Because this only works for the websites whose IDs are 123, 234, 345, and more likely we won't know what the IDs of these websites will be, right? So we need to create a pattern, right? We need to create like a placeholder. I don't know what the ID is, so it's slash website slash by whatever follows, okay? So to do that, we're going to remove these two here. I'm going to say colon website ID. I think I give you a particular pattern, WID, right? So WID. So slash colon WID. Make sense? All right. So if we go back now and refresh, right? Notice that any one of these, right? If I click on any one of them, navigates, notice that I have slash 123, 345, oops. If I click on this, it goes to 123, it goes to 345. They all navigate to the same edit website. Make sense? All right? What about new? Isn't new a specific instance of this pattern? Right? This is a specific instance of this pattern, right? So you got to be careful. If you instead declare this in this order, right? What will happen is that this pattern will overshadow, right? This pattern, right? Because this is a more generic pattern, right? That already includes new, right? So if I go back and I refresh, right? And if I click on this, obviously this works, right? These work. But if I click on plus, they still go to edit instead of new. See that? Because this pattern fired before this pattern because of the order. See that? So you should put specific patterns higher, declare them before declaring more generic patterns. Make sense? All right? All right. Okay. So we've declared navigation, and we're pretty... obviously, we haven't done all the other ones, right? I'm only showing you how to set it up, all right? Obviously, you have to go back and implement this a little further. But let's change our attention to these pages over here, right? On login and whatnot, and being able to implement them, right? Before we go any further, notice that we've been declaring all these three pages for the website, yes? Just like we did for the user, right? We're going to group these pages that naturally go together, right? We're going to group them into a parent directory, right? Because again, all these pages are going to just multiply, keep getting bigger, the number of pages. So, and it'll be make it much harder to keep track of all these pages. So we're going to group all these pages under a directory called website. Website, and we're going to move these pages in there. Okay? Since we moved them, we have to go back and change the configuration, yes? We're going to have to put here that all the websites actually live under website. Okay? Everybody good? And let's see if nothing has broken. Website still navigates, plus still goes to new. Okay, we haven't broken anything. All right, very good. Later on, we're going to work on another directory called page, or pages, right? I'm going to put a whole bunch of pages in there, right? Widgets, we're going to put all the widgets under there, right? So even these are getting bigger and bigger and bigger. How many do we have of these? So typically, there is an additional folder structure that allows us to manage that complexity, right? Grouping all these into a single directory called the views directory, right? These are all views. I'm going to drop them in there, views. Another common name is to use templates, right? We put them in there, so let's put it in there. Let's group, put them all under the views. There they are. Okay, that means we have to go back into our single page place of maintenance and update all these guys. No, this should be views, right? We have to fix that and refactor that. Again, different teams will have different naming conventions, different ways of organizing. Okay, and you just have to adhere to whatever the team agrees to. Yes. So up to this point, right, all this has been all this HTML is still just hard-coded HTML. Right? There's no dynamic anything here. Right? Any data that we're generating, any interaction is just being lost. Right? Nobody's listening other than the navigational portion of this. Right? There is a controller that is responsible for all the navigation, but there is no logic behind any of this just yet. So to implement the logic behind any one of these pages, we need to introduce another artifact. Okay? We need to introduce what it's called the controller, the page controller. Each one of these pages is going to be associated with a controller that's going to be responsible for interacting with the user, providing data to the user, retrieving data from the user, right? And listening for incoming events, right? And as the user clicks and drags and interacts, somebody has to be listening for all these events. Okay, all right. So let's do that. For the user, we need a couple of controllers. We'll need a controller for the login page. We'll need a controller for the register page and for the profile. Each view will have its own dedicated controller. Okay? So let's do that. Let's do that. Let's create our very first controller for the login page. Right? So the way we do that is that we're going to create a controller in the user page, in the user directory. We'll create a controller right here, JavaScript. We'll call it the login controller. All right, so there's also a naming convention here. It's a controller, right? That is its role in the overall framework, right? So somewhere in the name here should be the name controller, just like views have the view monitor, right? Also, it should also have in its name the fact that they are controllers are running or executing on the browser, right? So and they're responsible for a particular view, right? The login view. So we're going to capture that in the name of this controller. We're going to say login that controller dot client. Okay, and so the name suggests that it is a controller, meaning it's
the overall understanding of what a controller in general is that it receives events, right? It maps those events to actions. Oftentimes, those actions manipulate some data, right? Transform the data, and then provide the resulting data back to whoever invoked those events. Okay, that's a general architectural responsibility of a controller. Okay, who's generating the events? The view is going to be generating events, right? When they click on login, when they click on register, when they click on, you know, as they type, right? Those events are going to be handled by the controller, right? It is the controller's responsibility to receive the username and password, right? Verify that this user exists, right? Coming back and saying yes, this user is or not, right? And then telling the view, saying yes, you can go, no, you can't go, right? Let them through or not. All right, so let's create our very first controller. Again, like any other, like all JavaScript that you're going to ever write in this course, it needs to be embedded in an IFE, right? So that's the very first thing that you should write, okay? I'm going to declare a controller here, right? We're going to say, hey, Angular, everything starts with Angular, we're going to configure a controller in the module Web App Maker. We're going to declare a controller. Okay, just like we declared modules and we declare configurations, we can also declare controllers, right? And later on, there's a whole bunch of these functions that we're going to be using throughout, right? And we're going to introduce them as we go. But for now, let's use controller, right? And controller, you get to name your controller, right? In this particular case, we're going to call it the login controller. This is also a naming convention that your team will come up with. What are the names? You know, how are we going to call these things, right? And typically, you should follow that convention so that, you know, whenever you think of a controller that you would like, you can guess of what the controller should be called, right? If you're looking at a particular HTML file, and you say, "Oh, I wonder who's handling all the events." If you know the view, you know, hopefully you can also know what the name of the controller goes along with it. Okay, so login controller, and then you declare a function that implements that controller. This syntax uses the declaration of the function right as an argument, an embedded argument to a function call. I find it disturbing, the syntax. Nevertheless, this would work just fine. Notice it's a function. It's a nameless function, right? It's an anonymous function that is an argument. Notice that it's after this comma here. That is being passed as an argument. Notice that it's inside of a parentheses. You see that? This is very, very common in JavaScript, at least on the client side. On the client side, this is very, very common. Okay? And the reason it's common is that, again, we don't want to give names. Right? We are so scared of naming things, right? Of littering the namespace, right? That we try to use any syntax that we can use to avoid naming things. Colliding with names declared by others, okay? Because the world is using lots and lots of libraries all over the place, yes? But we don't have that problem here because we are in our own little namespace, yes? We don't have that problem. It is okay for us to name these functions. So I am not going to use this syntax. I'm not going to use that syntax. Instead, I'm going to say the controller is called login controller. I'm going to use the same name that I am going to quote, right? And I'm going to declare the function down here. All right? Everybody okay? Right?
That name up there that says in quotes, right, that name makes this controller available throughout the environment, throughout the framework. I can refer to this controller by name from anywhere in the framework. Okay? Just like I am referring to Web App Maker from this file, right? This file is saying, hey, there should be a module called Web App Maker that somebody else declared. I want to retrieve it. Now I have the instance of that module, and now I'm going to keep adding stuff to it. Somebody declared it at the very top. Somebody configured it. Now I am going to add, declare a controller on the module. Yes? Everybody okay? All right, so I named it. There it is.
And I can do console hello from login controller. Okay? All right, so we declare this JavaScript. We need to load the JavaScript, like just like any other JavaScript needs to be loaded, yes? Who does the loading? Only index does loading, right? No other HTML does loading. So let's load it. I'm going to load it right here. Script source. I know it's under views. I know it's under user. And I know it's login control. There it is. Right? So I load it. Now it's been loaded. If I run this, right, if I go back to login, if I go back, profile, and I can't log out, and I'm in login, oops, something went wrong. Console, it's saying resource, yada, yada, 404, uh-oh. Compile, yada, 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 yada. What is this? The server just crashed? No, it's still running. Line compile, yada, 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 yada. It says login view that client.html does not exist. Oh, see, it's trying to find login view client.html. I can't find it. Did I put it in the wrong place? Config. Here's login view client. Is it not? Did I rename it wrong? Views. User, login, view, client.html. That looks right. Login, view, client.html. Interesting. I'm trying to go to login and I can't find. Maybe I had something cached. Let me see. Logout. Okay, I must have had something cached. Oh, yeah, I must have had an old version of profile. I came back to it, right? And it had the wrong config map to it. Okay, fine. All right, so what do we want to do here? Okay, so what we want to do is now that I have a controller that's not really doing anything, right, it's only saying hello, I want to map it to this HTML. I want to say the controller for this HTML is that login controller over there. Okay? So let's do that. So the way we're going to do that is as follows. Here in the configuration, we can say that HTML, when that HTML loads, also load the relevant controller that goes along with that HTML. We can say the controller for this view is that login controller, which I named. I gave it a name, didn't I? Right? I think I called it login controller. Yes? And what that's going to do is that it's going to instantiate, create an instance. This is a constructor. This is a JavaScript constructor. It's going to use it to create an instance of the controller, right? And whenever that page loads, this instance will be available, right, to handle that HTML, right? So let's try that. If I load this HTML, notice that it says hello from login controller. See that? If I would have instead navigated elsewhere, that controller would have not loaded. So this indeed is being instantiated. I am passing right through here. Everybody okay? All right? Okay. Okay, so how can these two talk to one another? Right? Well, they talk to each other by a magical object called the scope. Right? The HTML document, declares a div, declares its own HTML piece, right? Everything that's inside that HTML document, everything that is in that DOM object that is declared for that particular template is the scope, right? Meaning that outside of that template, the login page has no business touching anything, right? If there's a top level header and a bottom, an overall
left-hand side, and and there's a whole bunch of other things. Yes, the login page has no business touching those things, right? The only, the only thing the login page should care about is that username input field, that password input field, the login button, and the register button. That is the only thing that it should be responsible for. Anything outside is outside of its scope. See that? Right, that's why we call it the scope, right?
The scope allows you to have this HTML and this controller talk to one another, right? And let's do that, right? The login controller can ask the framework to pass it its scope.
Pass me my scope, right? Meaning anything that is declared in that HTML template, I am responsible for that HTML, okay? So pass me anything that has to do with me that I can manipulate, right?
And now this scope,
we say that the scope binds the JavaScript and the HTML are now bound. Anything that the HTML does to the scope, the controller knows about. And anything that the controller does to the scope, the HTML knows about, right? And they can interact and talk to one another through the scope.
For instance, I could say scope, I can declare a variable on the scope, right? I can declare a variable called hello, right? And I can say, I can remove this and say this is the variable hello, right? Since the controller declared a variable called hello and it bonds some value, that hello variable is now available on the view, on the HTML. Okay, how? Let's see. Okay. We'll go to the login page, to the login template, which is way down here. And the easiest way that I can reference things on the scope declared by my controller, the easiest way is to just refer to it with these funny looking curly brackets. I can say hello. Right? Any variable declared on the controller is available here. Any variable that is declared in the view is also available in the controller. There, we call that two-way binding, right? And you'll see how powerful that is. Right? So if I declare, notice it says hello
from the login controller, right? The controller declared some data on a variable, and that variable is now available on the view, and vice versa, right?
The view can also declare variables, right? The view can declare variables. For instance, I can associate data with this input field, right? That's data. Somebody's going to type on it, right? Somebody's going to type some data. Somehow I need to grab it, right? So I can name it. I can name the data that is going to be associated with this input field. I can say, it's username. Well, I think that's a good name for this data, right? I could say ng model username, right? Meaning model, meaning data, right? The data.
I am declaring a new variable called username, and it's tied to whatever is in this input field. If you type something on the input field, everywhere where the username variable is referenced, we'll be notified that, hey, the username has changed as you type. Right? Anyone who references the username variable will be notified,
okay? Including the controller. The controller will know if the username has changed, okay? Or anywhere else on the page, for instance, I can, I can refer to variables declared on the controller, I can refer to variables declared right here on the page, right? So I could type with this, funny-looking curly brackets, username, okay? And if I reload, as I type my username, notice that the page is being modified, right? Okay? With any formatting that I want to apply to it, right? If I refresh, right, and as I type, J anon z, Right, notice what's happening here, right?
Anywhere where that variable is being declared, right, is declaring an interest on the current value of that variable. It says, hey, I want to know what the value of that variable is. If it ever changes, let me know. Okay, so it's creating, to be able to support this, it's creating all sorts of event handlers, right, and listening for changes on the keystrokes, right? You know, anything that would affect the value of that variable, okay, the overall framework, it's listening for changes, right? And anyone who declares an interest on that variable will be notified. Okay, yes. Certainly. Underneath all this jQuery.
Oh.
Okay.
So you would you still link to jQuery?
Yeah, so what happens is that below all this is a layer of jQuery, right? And on top of this, they've created a high level abstraction over it. So that we no longer think about the DOM, or we no longer think about manipulating specific pieces of HTML or pieces of CSS. Instead, we create an object-oriented way. So, for instance, a controller will never know that it's manipulating a particular element in the HTML. Instead, it all thinks about JSON objects, you know, an abstraction, objects, and arrays, right? It never knows what the actual DOM looks like, because that's the responsibility of the view. The view is the one who cares how this is going to be rendered, and, you know, what kind of styling is going to be used. So that's the responsibility of the view. So what Angular does is that it forces you to think in these two different worlds, right? Instead of having the controller know about the HTML, the HTML knowing about the controller, you know, and sending events to a controller, or the controller manipulating the DOM, which is the jQuery way of doing things, it severs this. It says, no. I know that underneath that's all happening. I'm going to create a layer of abstraction that says the view only does view things, and the controller only does controller things, right? And the way they talk to one another is with this object-oriented mechanism, right? The controller only manipulates objects, and the view has access to those objects, and it then renders it. It iterates over arrays, you can see objects and attributes and things, right? And navigate through this data model, and then render it in which way you want. Now, oftentimes, I guess for the most part, right, for doing conventional things, you don't need jQuery. But oftentimes, you want to go a little bit outside the beaten path, and really have direct access to the DOM, right? And Angular also allows you to do that, right? And create your own jQuery components, right? That you can then, you know, make it part as of the overall framework. And we'll do that. Okay, we'll definitely do that through directives. Right? I think we're out of time.
I'm gonna push this to the repository. Please, you know, start working on the assignment. Use any and all parts of this as an example, which I hope will help you. Thank you.